In central Norway lies the remains of the medieval Sverresborg Castle, built around 1180 CE. And in the 1930s, excavations of these ruins revealed a corpse at the bottom of a well from within the castle walls. The skeleton revealed that this individual had sustained serious injuries, which, okay, yeah, like obviously he was found in a well, which had been filled with boulders after he was thrown in. I mean, what a way to go. And with such a clearly dramatic end, you might be thinking, what a shame this guy's story has been lost to history. I guess we'll never really know what events led to this dramatic demise. Except buckle up, because I'm about to tell you exactly what happened. And it's all thanks to a seemingly unlikely trio: carbon dating, DNA analysis, and Old Norse sagas. This body was initially found during early excavations of the castle ruins in 1938, turning up about 5 meters down a well and covered in large stones. At the time, there wasn't a whole lot that could be done to identify the skeleton, scientifically speaking. It was just some guy in a well, so he came to be known as Well Man. And this first excavation wasn't well documented either, so there wasn't a good record of the fate of these found bones and how they were treated at the time of their discovery. Decades later, when it was decided that Sverresborg Castle should be turned into a tourist destination, dealing with the well skeleton became a priority again. So in 2014, researchers set out to relocate and remove the skeleton from the ruins and try to learn more about the mysterious Well Man. They were only able to recover part of the skeleton. But even with that fragmentary material, these researchers learned a lot from what they found compared to its first excavation. By looking for specific skeletal features, researchers can get some idea of the age and biological sex of the skeleton. For example, in adults, they'll look at skull and pelvic bone morphology to help differentiate between sexes. This process isn't perfect, and skeletons can only give you an idea of sex, to say nothing of the cultural experience of gender, but archaeologists work with what they have. In the case of this particular skeleton, they looked largely at the pelvic region to infer that this was a male between 30 and 40 years of age at his death. At this stage, they also used radiocarbon dating to figure out when this well man found himself in the bottom of a well to begin with, a method that wasn't available at the time of the first excavation. Radiocarbon dating can be used to determine when something or someone died, as long as the sample is around 55,000 years old or younger. This method looks at the degradation of a specific radioactive isotope of carbon, carbon-14, which has more neutrons than most carbon on Earth does. These special carbon atoms break down at a specific rate, which makes it a great tool for tracking time. Carbon-14 makes its way into living things via photosynthesis and is cycled around through the food chain. While still alive, all organisms are readily exchanging carbon with the environment, so their carbon-14 concentrations stay relatively consistent. But once something kicks the bucket, no new carbon-14 is taken in, and it's a one-way street of carbon decay. So using radiocarbon dating, we can roughly estimate what year something died. And in the case of Well Man, the first carbon dating estimates put his time of death sometime between 1154 and 1285 CE. That's a pretty wide range, because radiocarbon dating can only get us in the ballpark, not down to specific years. There are a lot of factors that throw off our ability to narrow it down further. For example, diet can cause the remains of organisms to appear younger than they really were. Like, if you eat a lot of fish, your remains might throw future scientists for a loop, because carbon makes its way through marine environments at different rates than terrestrial ones. So the researchers ran the calculation a couple of ways to account for that, and came up with that not quite century and a half range. A more recent study in 2024 made a few other estimates based on a likely diet of around 20% seafood and presented a very similar range of somewhere between 1153 and 1277 CE. Further excavations took place in 2016, which revealed even more information, including some gruesome details about the skeleton. For one, Wellman's left arm was nowhere to be found, though they did find the fingers that went with that arm. His skull was found, though not attached to his body, and it had sustained some serious blunt force trauma. And to get even more gruesome, these head injuries seem to have occurred before he was thrown into the well, not after. And in the most recent research paper on this skeleton from 2024, another piece of the puzzle was revealed using genetic data of not only well man's remains, but that of ancient and modern Norwegians too. The researchers took the DNA data of thousands of modern day Norwegians and compared their genetics to the well man's, as well as the DNA of 23 other medieval Norwegians. These types of studies allow us to learn more about who was where and when, through direct comparison of regionally specific DNA patterns that show up over time. And this particular exploration of Wellman's genetic roots established that the individual came from a population in southern Norway. His DNA analysis also led to the not-so-shocking revelation that he had blue eyes, fair skin, and blonde or light brown hair. I mean, it is Norway after all. Though even this portion of the study wasn't completed without some hiccups, as the DNA sampling itself was a wee bit more complicated than you'd hope for. Given that this particular skeleton had been handled a number of times since its initial discovery in 1938, surface contamination was likely, so they had to sterilize and then grind up a tooth to get a sample without contamination from modern DNA. So after many decades and trials and tribulations, we now know he was a blue-eyed southern Norwegian from the 12th or 13th century. But what we know about Wellman's story doesn't actually end there. There's more to know about Wellman because an ancient Norse saga specifically mentions this exact dude. Not by name, but it turns out we know a lot more than just what the science revealed. Now, we're talking about some seriously old sagas, based on events from medieval Norway beginning around 1060 CE. These sagas are part of an incredibly durable storytelling tradition in Iceland, passed down through the centuries and shared with their neighbors. And we're about to see exactly how much detail they can contain. Long story short, in the 12th century, a guy named King Sverre rose to power, and in classic kingly fashion, he became embroiled in a lot of conflict during his reign. King Sverre spent much of his time at war with the representatives of the Roman Catholic Church called the Baglers. And in 1197, the Baglers carried out a sneak attack on Sverresborg Castle, one of his strongholds. The Baglers not only burnt down all the houses inside the castle grounds, but the saga from this time also tells the tale of Baglers throwing a dead man down a well and then filling it in with a bunch of huge rocks. While we don't know for sure why they did this, it seems likely that they were set on making the castle uninhabitable for King Sverre and his followers going forward. A pretty good strategy for accomplishing this would be to poison the water supply, like with a dead body, for example. Based on the age of the skeleton and the circumstances under which it was found, there's basically no doubt that Wellman is that dude. There's one interesting twist, which is that the Baglers were from the south, while King Sverre and his men were from central Norway. So given Wellman's southern DNA, it's possible that Wellman was not one of King Sverre's men that was killed in the raid, but actually a Bagler, which would mean they poisoned the well with one of their own dead. Unfortunately, this part of the tale remains a mystery. He could have been a Bagler. He could have also been some dude from the south who just happened to be living out his life at King Sverre's fortress when the Baglers stormed the castle. We'll probably never know. While a lot of the specific details of Wellman will always remain a mystery, what we do know is that the archaeological and genetic evidence seem to line up perfectly with the Norse sagas describing this period of time. The discovery of Wellman provides an incredible demonstration of how science and traditional storytelling can be used to reinforce each other in the historical record and strengthen our understanding of human history. This also speaks to the durability of the Scandinavian storytelling tradition, since we found literally the exact guy from these stories written down centuries ago. So thank you, Wellman. I'm sure you would have wanted things to end differently, but you truly became the stuff of legends. Legends that have since been nicely corroborated with the help of modern science.